Good morning. Today we're talking about the biblical gift of prophecy. And this is the fourth part of a series of sermons we've been talking about. And they may somewhat seem to be connected, and some parts may not be as connected, but we'll try to tie it all together and bring it in here for you today. But the last 3 weeks we've been speaking about, really fundamentally, how God achieves unity and work in His church. And we began 3 weeks ago talking about the ecumenical movement, if you remember that. The ecumenical movement is the idea that all these churches can work together regardless of what they believe, but they actually unify on one great point. What is that one point?
Trinity.
They unify on the doctrine of the Trinity. If you believe the Trinity, you can believe everything else. And you're supposed to accept everybody else. For instance, if you're in Church A over here, you're supposed to accept the work of Church B. As long as they all believe in the Trinity, they're doing ultimately the same work. Something I didn't bring out 3 weeks ago that probably I should have, and maybe I will take time to do it today, but something you may or may not know about, but since 1926, there's been something called the Working Policy of the General Conference. The General Conference actually had a working policy, or they were trying to have what, you know, policies of how to work, and they sort of turned it over what they called the General Conference Executive Committee in 1926, and they've been publishing what they call the working policy of the General Conference since then. But as far back as even 1926, which was 11 years after Ellen White died, we find this statement that was published in the working policy, and it is still in the working policy of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. It's on the website. In fact, it was very hard for me to find it. I Googled it, and I found it quoted in several places, but I could not find it on the General Conference's website. But then I went to a Bing search, and I found it through Bing. I was surprised. But it says this: "We recognize those agencies that lift up Christ before men as a part of the divine plan for evangelization of the world, and we hold in high esteem Christian men and women in other communities who are engaged in winning souls to Christ." It's point one of policy number 075 in the General Conference Working Policy, and then I have the address of where you can access it. Now, that really, in some ways, doesn't sound so bad if it really means what it says. We recognize those agencies that lift up Christ. The problem is, does the Trinity lift up Christ, or does it lift up a false Christ?
False Christ.
It lifts up a false Christ. But of course, by this time, the church is starting to move toward a Trinitarian position. They're only 5 years away from publishing a fundamental statement of belief that says that they believe in the Trinity. And so the concept of ecumenicalism was coming in even to Adventism a long time ago. 2 weeks ago, we talked about the unity of the Spirit. And we mentioned that doctrine must be established before we start doing exhortation on that doctrine. We notice especially in Ephesians, if you look at the first three chapters of Ephesians, Paul lays out the doctrine first, and then he brings in the exhortation and this concept of being in unity after that, but not before. We saw that the unity of the Spirit is the Spirit's unity. And that Spirit is the Spirit of truth. It guides into truth and is the author of the book of truth. And just to review a couple quick quotations, in Manuscript Releases, Volume 8, page 68.4, it says, "We are often exhorted, be ye all of one mind, which means the same as endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bonds of peace." And there Ellen White is quoting Ephesians 4:3 that we were especially focusing on that day. So to keep the unity of the Spirit, because sometimes people will say, well, you know, we just want to have the right spirit. If we can just get in unity in our spirit, then we'll figure out the doctrines. But she says this means to have the one mind, and that's the mind of Christ. It's not a mind of 500 different ideas. She also said in Selected Messages, Book 1, page 175.1, "Christ calls for unity, but He does not call for us to unify on wrong practices. The God of heaven draws a sharp contrast between pure, elevating, ennobling truth and false, misleading doctrines. He calls sin and impenitence by the right name. He does not gloss over wrongdoing with a coat of untempered mortar. I urge our brethren to unify upon a true scriptural basis." That's from Selected Messages, Book 1, page 175. But there's a portion of this quotation I wanted to just make a comment on that I didn't 2 weeks ago. And that's near the end of the statement. He, that is God, does not gloss over wrongdoings with a coat of untempered mortar. When I learned to lay block and work with mortar, I learned about tempering the mortar. There's a process you go by to temper the mortar. And Kevin, what does it do when we temper the mortar? What does it do to the mortar?
More workable.
It's more workable and it's harder. It will dry harder, more permanent. In other words, God doesn't just gloss over error with something that's going to crumble and fade away. He says this is serious business. Last week we talked about spiritual gifts and we noted that there were three primary sources in the New Testament that gives a list of those spiritual gifts, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, Romans chapter 12, and Ephesians chapter 4. And we gave you these slides, or slides very similar to these. In the next slide we have here, a list from 1 Corinthians 12, 8 through 10, and verse 28. You have the word of wisdom, word of knowledge, faith, gifts of healing. Remember we mentioned gifts, plural. Miracles, prophecy and prophets, discernment, tongues, interpretation of tongues, apostles, teachers, helps, and governments. And in Romans chapter 12, Paul there speaks about prophecy, ministry, teaching, and exhortation. We especially focused a little bit on exhortation so we didn't misunderstand what it meant. It dealt with encouraging, appealing. It has many nuances. And then finally in Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 11, you have there those five famous or pretty well known offices or responsibilities in the church that are called also gifts of the Spirit: apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. But we said today that we would focus on one of these gifts, and that particularly is the gift of prophecy or gift of prophets. And so the first thing I want to do today is ask very simply, what or whom is a prophet? What or whom is a prophet? Well, just a couple of the quicker biblical dictionary definitions. The HarperCollins Bible Dictionary says that you have a prophet is a person who serves as a channel of communication between the human and divine worlds. The Easton Bible Dictionary says a prophet was a spokesman for God. He spake in God's name and by his authority. He is the mouth by which God speaks to man. Jeremiah 1:9, Isaiah 51:16. And hence, what the prophet says is not of man, but of God. 2 Peter 1:20 and 21. And we'll look at some of these other texts today as we go. Now, the Hebrew word nabi means spokesman or prophet. The Greek word prophetes means prophet, or it actually comes from two words, as it notes. It comes from the word pro, and we use this prefix in English a lot. It means before, and phimi, which means to declare or say. So something they're saying before it happens. That's basically the meaning of those Hebrew and Greek words primarily that are translated as such. A prophet's primary function in the Old Testament was to serve as God's representative or ambassador by communicating God's word to his people. We were talking in our local Sabbath school here a little bit about Jesus being an ambassador, weren't we? And he came and he brought the word of God to us, didn't he? In fact, in John chapter 1, verse 1, it says, "In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God." Jesus is called the word of God. He brings God's word to us. Interestingly, the first person that's actually called a prophet in the Bible is Abraham. The first person that we know as being a prophet would have been Enoch, of course, because the Bible in Jude says that he prophesied of the coming of Christ even. So Enoch was a Seventh-day Adventist, by the way. You knew that, didn't you? Because he kept the seventh-day Sabbath and he was looking for the coming of Jesus. So he was a Seventh-day Adventist. Adam was too. He kept the Sabbath and looked for the coming of Christ. He'd been given the promise of the Messiah. But in the olden times, they weren't called prophets. They were called seers. Turn with me to 1 Samuel chapter 9. In verse 9, it says, "Before time in Israel, when a man went to inquire of God, thus he spake, Come, and let us go to the seer. For he that is now called a prophet was before time called a seer." So in the time when Samuel was written, they were using the term prophet. But before that, they say, let's go to the seer. And they would call him a seer because he would be able to see, foresee what was happening or what God wanted them to know. A vital, a crucial characteristic of a prophet, friends, is a call from God. You just can't make yourself a prophet. Did you get it?
Got it.
I might like to be a prophet, but I just can't decide I'm going to become a prophet. If I want to take a trade and become a welder like Brother Alan or a mechanic like Brother Andy, I can learn to do those things and I can become a mechanic, I can become a welder. But I can't just become a prophet. That has to be a calling from God. And attempting to prophesy without such a commission is false prophecy, and it becomes a lie. Turn with me to Jeremiah chapter 14. Jeremiah 14, 14. Then the Lord said unto me, now this is Jeremiah writing, right? And the Lord spoke to Jeremiah. Jeremiah was a prophet. Then the Lord said unto me, the prophets prophesy lies in my name. I sent them not, neither have I commanded them, neither spake unto them. They prophesy unto you a false vision and divination and a thing of naught and the deceit of their hearts. So they really weren't really even prophets. But people called them prophets, so God referred to them as they were known. But they were false prophets. They weren't really prophets at all. And he says that God did not send them. He did not command them. They didn't speak from him. And he says that this came from the deceit of their heart. And in Jeremiah chapter 17, he speaks a little bit about our heart. Jeremiah 17, 9. He says, the heart is deceitful and desperately wicked. He says, it is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked, and who can know it? Well, I can see how it would be easy for people to be trapped into a situation by Satan thinking, oh, I'm a prophet, or I could be a prophet, and I want to be a prophet, and, you know, my heart tells me I'm a prophet, but our hearts are deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. And only through the help of and the grace of God can we know what our heart is really like. A true prophet never spoke their own words or on their own authority. They were not at liberty to share their personal opinions, but only the message God gave them. Now, we think of the Bible as a composition of 66 books by about 40 different authors. But if we turn to 2 Peter chapter 1, we sort of get a summation of how all this came together. 2 Peter chapter 1 and verses 20 and 21. He says, knowing this first, that no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost or the Holy Spirit. It wasn't just anyone that could be a prophet. They were holy people. They were people that God could use. And the Bible, what we have today, these writings, the Scriptures, it was given by holy men who weren't speaking their own words, but they were speaking the words that God gave them. We could think of some examples. What about Moses? Was Moses a prophet? Oh, yes, he was. He spoke the words of God. Let's just notice a few verses. Exodus chapter 4. Exodus 4, verse 12. Now, therefore, go, and I will be with thy mouth and teach thee what thou shalt say. So the things that Moses was to take forth, they weren't to be his own words. He was going to go and visit before Pharaoh and say, let my people go. And by the way, Moses said, you know, I can't speak the Egyptian language very well, remember? And one of the gifts of the Spirit is the gift of tongues. But God didn't give Moses the ability to speak the Egyptian language really well to Pharaoh. What did he do instead? He provided Aaron, who could speak it well. And that's a point that we need to consider. On the day of Pentecost, when the people spake in tongues or in languages, there was a need for it. And God provided the miracle because there was a need. Amen. But when he could supply that need in a different way, he didn't provide the miracle. That's an interesting point. And the same is true, friends, with prophets. When God has already sent a message, he doesn't need to perform a miracle to resend it five times, six times, seven times. In Deuteronomy 18 and verse 18, here Moses speaks about Christ, and he compares him to himself even. He says, and I'll read verse 17 also, Deuteronomy 18, verse 17 and 18, "And the Lord said unto me, they have well spoken that which they have spoken, and I will raise up a prophet from among their brethren like unto thee, and will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak unto them all that I shall command him." And that prophet specifically was Christ. But Christ came and spoke the words the Father gave him, and Moses spake the words the Father gave him. And if I come here today and tell you, you know, I'm a prophet, and I think God wanted me to tell you this, I can tell you for a very fact, the moment I say, I think God wanted me to tell you this, I'm false prophet.
Amen.
Because God tells you exactly what to say. You don't have to think this is what God wants you to say. You know what God wants you to say. I mean, he may give you the freedom to word it in your own ways. You know, sometimes he gives thought inspiration. Sometimes he does give verbal inspiration. But it's from the Lord. In Jeremiah chapter 1, we read some statements in Jeremiah, but let's go back to Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 9 now. You know, Jeremiah was a reluctant prophet at first. And he tried to excuse himself. He says, I can't speak. I'm just a child. He wasn't a child like a baby, but he was a young man. And God said in verse 8, "Be not afraid of their faces, for I am with thee to deliver thee, saith the Lord." And then verse 9, "Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth, and the Lord said unto me, behold, I have put my words in thy mouth." Again, this is not guesswork, friends. This is the word of the Lord coming to the prophet. Ezekiel comes almost right after Jeremiah. After Jeremiah, you have what little book?
Lamentations,
and then Ezekiel. Ezekiel chapter 2 and verse 7. Ezekiel 2, 7. He says, "Thou shalt speak whatever you want to this people." Is that what the text says? "And thou shalt speak my words unto them, whether they will hear or whether they will forbear, for they are most rebellious." Look, Ezekiel is told by God, you're going to say my words, whether they want to hear it or not. You give them my word. And that's what the prophet does. And we could look at several other examples, and maybe we should. Hosea chapter 1 and verse 2. The beginning of the word of the Lord by Hosea. So, how did Hosea get the word?
It was given to him
by the Lord. Joel is the next book of the Bible. Let's go to Joel chapter 1 and verse 1. It says, "The word of the Lord that came to Joel." How did Joel get the word? The Lord gave it to him. And we could look at Micah chapter 1, verse 1, Amos chapter 1, verse 3. And you see, as you look through all these prophets, that it was because God gave them the word, friends. It wasn't their word. Now, I have good news for all you ladies. The prophetic office was not restricted only to men. That's right. In Exodus chapter 15 and verse 20, we read about Miriam, and she was called a prophetess. "And Miriam the prophetess, the sister of Aaron, took a tremble in her hand, and all the women went out after her with trembles and with dances." So Miriam was called a prophetess, even though Miriam made some mistakes at times, you know. The Lord still used her. Deborah was a prophetess in Judges chapter 4. And verse 4, "And Deborah, a prophetess, the wife of Lipidoth, she judged Israel at that time." And so we see there were women who were prophets. In Acts chapter 21 and verses 8 and 9, we'll probably read this later, but there were daughters of Philip, and they were prophets. Now, How does the word of the Lord come to the prophet? How does it come? Sometimes it came by an audible voice. Sometimes it came by an audible voice that they actually heard. Not just simply an impression. Sometimes we're not told. Like we were reading there in Joel, the word of the Lord came to Joel. We don't know how the word of the Lord came always. It just says it came to them. But as an example, if we would turn to 1 Samuel chapter 3. 1 Samuel chapter 3. This was the call of Samuel. He was a young child at this time. And remember, he was staying there with Eli. And in verse 4, it says, "And the Lord called Samuel, and he answered, 'Here am I.'" But in verse 5, it says he ran to Eli and said, "Here am I, for thou callest me." And he said, "I call not. Lie down again." And he went and lay down. And the Lord called yet again, "Samuel." And Samuel rose and went to Eli and said, "I am here, for thou didst call me." And he answered, "I called not, my son, lie down again." I mean, very clearly, Samuel is just not having a dream. He's not having a vision. He's hearing something, and he thinks he hears Eli calling him. And this happened again. And Eli understood the Lord was speaking to the young boy. And he said, "If you hear it again, say, 'Speak, Lord, for thy servant heareth.'" And he heard. What a beautiful thing. Sometimes God would speak to prophets through dreams and visions. In Numbers chapter 12, we are trying to look at what the Bible says about the biblical gift of prophecy here today. And I want to tell you, this is a really, really big subject of the Bible. There's so much in the Bible about this. We're only really looking at a sort of an outline of it today, because we could study this for several weeks by itself, of all these gifts that we're talking about. But in Numbers chapter 12 and verse 6, and he said, "Hear now my words, if there be a prophet among you, I, the Lord, will make myself known unto him in a vision, and will speak unto him in a dream." And he did this in many times. Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 1. It says, "The vision of Isaiah, the son of Amos, which he saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem in the days of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah." So here it speaks about Isaiah, and he had a vision. He saw something in this vision. That's why they call it a vision. The difference between a dream and a vision. A dream happens when you're asleep. When you're awake, you have a vision. The Spirit of God comes upon you, and you see something while you are awake. The dream happens at night. Ezekiel chapter 8 and verse 1 is another example. "And it came to pass in the sixth year, in the sixth month, in the fifth day of the month, as I sat in mine house, and the elders of Judah sat before me, that the hand of the Lord God fell there upon me. Then I beheld, and lo, a likeness," and so on. So he's seeing something, he's having a vision, but he was sitting there with the elders of Judah, and they were together, and then the Spirit of God came upon him, and he saw these things that were to be depicted. I think about Elijah. Elijah is a prophet. But we don't really have any detail about how he was called to that prophetic office, except that we know that he was extremely zealous for the cause of God. And he saw the apostasy that Israel was in. And he remembered those promises from Deuteronomy, that God said, "If you do this, I will bless you. If you do this, I will curse you, and I will withhold the rain from you." And he actually prayed for God to withhold the rain from Israel, to try to wake them up. And in the book Prophets and Kings on page 120, paragraph 2, it says, "To Elijah was entrusted the mission of delivering to Ahab heaven's message of judgment. He did not seek to be the Lord's messenger. The word of the Lord came to him." We're not told how the word of the Lord came to him, just simply the word of the Lord came to him. But only why it says that he was praying, and God told him his prayer was answered and he was to be used. Now, we don't know how God told him that. Okay. You know, I have to be honest with you. I've met many people in my life, as you have too, and in our, I guess, association with some of the people that we run with, we frequently meet people, or I have, who tell me something like this: "The Lord told me to dot, dot, dot." Have you ever heard people tell you that? "The Lord told me to," and I'm always there wondering, now, how just did the Lord tell you to do this? Did you hear an audible voice? Did you have a vision? Did you dream a dream? Did another prophet come and tell you, "This is the word of the Lord"? Now, all those things can happen. But I want to tell you, a lot of the times when I hear people say, "The Lord told me," I don't think the Lord told them at all. Now, I'm not discounting it it certainly can happen, but we better make sure it really happens. And I'm going to show you why in just a few minutes. Because if we are going to claim that God is giving us special communications, I want to tell you, He will hold us to a strict standard of judgment. Because just even a prophet that was able, or a so-called prophet, for instance, that was able to perform miracles was not necessarily accepted. Let me just show you an example. Turn to Deuteronomy chapter 13. Deuteronomy chapter 13. Deuteronomy 13 verse 1. He says, "If there arise among you a prophet or a dreamer of dreams, and he giveth thee a sign or a what?
Wonder.
Now this word sign in Hebrew, and the word that's translated wonders in Hebrew, are also translated in other places miracles. He does a sign or he does a wonder. In other words, he's doing a miracle. He's doing something that seems to be supernatural. And he says, and the sign or the wonder come to pass. He says, there's something great going to happen, and it happens. Wherefore he spake unto thee, saying, let us go after other gods, which thou hast not known, and let us serve them. Thou shalt not hearken unto the words of that prophet, or that dreamer of dreams, for the Lord your God proveth you to know whether ye love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul." In other words, friends, if someone claims to be a prophet, and even if they can claim to do miracles or have signs and wonders, foretell you something is going to happen, and it happens, and yet they tell you to follow some other god, or they try to lead you into error, says, don't follow that person. They're not a real prophet. Now, it's true. Their words must come to pass. In Deuteronomy 18 and verse 22, if they are really a true prophet, their words will come to pass. Deuteronomy 18 and verse 22. It says, "When a prophet speaketh in the name of the Lord, if the thing follow not nor come to pass, that is the thing which the Lord hath not spoken. But the prophet has spoken it presumptuously, thou shalt not be afraid of him." So there is a place to look for things to be fulfilled. But if they don't be fulfilled, you don't have to worry about that person, because they're not from the Lord. And I want you to keep your hand here in Deuteronomy 18, because we're going to come right back really close in just a minute. But turn with me to Jeremiah 28. Jeremiah 28. And I won't take time to read the whole chapter, but you might want to read the whole chapter of Jeremiah 28. And I'll start in verse 1, though. "And it came to pass the same year, in the beginning of the reign of Zedekiah, king of Judah, in the fourth year and in the fifth month, that Hananiah, the son of Azur, the prophet, which was of Gibeon, spake unto me in the house of the Lord, in the presence of the priests and all the people, saying, thus speaketh the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, saying, I have broken the yoke of the king of Babylon. Within two full years I will bring again into this place all the vessels of the Lord's house that Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, took away from this place and carried them to Babylon." You see, before this, Nebuchadnezzar had been there once before, and they had taken away some of the holy sacred things. And he says, in 2 years, this yoke of Nebuchadnezzar is going to be broken. Verse 4, "And I will bring again to this place Jeconiah, the son of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, with all the captives of Judah that went into Babylon, saith the Lord, for I will break the yoke of the king of Babylon." Verse 5, "Then the prophet Jeremiah said unto the prophet Hananiah, in the presence of the priests and in the presence of all the people that stood in the house of the Lord, even the prophet Jeremiah said, Amen. And the Lord do so. And the Lord perform thy works which thou hast prophesied, to bring again the vessels of the Lord's house, and all that is carried away captive from Babylon unto this place. Nevertheless, hear thou now this word that I speak in thine ears and in the ears of all the people. The prophets that have been before me and before thee of old prophesied, both against many countries and against great kingdoms, and of war and of evil and of pestilence. The prophet which prophesies of peace, when the word of the prophet shall come to pass, then shall the prophet be known that the Lord hath truly sent him. Then Hananiah the prophet took the yoke from off of the prophet Jeremiah's neck and brake it." You see, before this, Jeremiah had put this wood yoke around his neck. And he said, look, you know, don't listen to these people who say that you're going to be freed from Babylon. These false prophets were saying, look, Babylon's going to be, their rule over us is going to be broken. And Jeremiah had put this wooden yoke upon him to indicate, no, this isn't going to happen. And so the false prophet, and Jeremiah, you know, when he hears the false prophet, he mocks him almost. I mean, he's being sarcastic. When he says, amen, the Lord do so, he's being sarcastic. He's not saying, I agree with you. And this Hananiah took the yoke and he broke it. And he said, well, within two more years, it's going to happen. Verse 12, but the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah the prophet after that Hananiah, the prophet, had broken the yoke from off the neck of the prophet Jeremiah. And he says, go unto Hananiah, saying, thus saith the Lord, thou hast broken the yokes of wood, but thou shalt make for them yokes of iron. For thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, I have put a yoke of iron upon the neck of all these nations, that they may serve Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, and they shall serve him, and I have given him the beasts of the field also. And Jeremiah prophesied that false prophet was going to die, and he did. And he did. Now, God takes this pretty seriously. And if we go back to Deuteronomy 18, and verse 20 now. He says, but the prophet which shall presume to speak a word in my name, which I have not commanded him to speak, or that shall speak in the name of other gods, even that prophet shall die. God says, I'm going to put the death penalty upon people who claim to be prophets who are not. Because it is so serious, friends, because a prophet among God's people has such an influence. A true prophet has a great influence, has a great responsibility, and when someone tries to take that upon themselves, they are going to mislead people, and people are going to be brought into confusion. And it's confusion to the extent, and it's so serious that God says, that person has to be put to death. That's serious. Now, prophets didn't just simply predict the future. Yes, they were called seers, but they were more. They were God's voice to make known the holiness of God and His covenant obligations. They were to denounce injustices. Remember, Nathan came in before David and he said, thou art the man. 2 Samuel 12:7. They would denounce idolatry and empty ritualism. And they were to call God's covenant people to repentance and faithfulness. The work of a prophet could actually entail many things. And being a prophet could actually be pretty dangerous. Could be pretty dangerous. 2 Chronicles 36. And, you know, the way we have our Bibles arranged today is a little different than the Jewish Bible was arranged. In the Jewish Bible, 2 Chronicles was like the end of the Bible. It was like the end of the Bible. And this connects with something Jesus said. And maybe we'll show that. But in 2 Chronicles 36, verse 16, it says, but they mocked the messengers of God and despised his words and misused his prophets until the wrath of the Lord rose against his people till there was no remedy. Yes, they treated the prophets terribly. And if we go to Luke 11 and verse 51, This is certainly not a sermon. This is a didactic message here today. We're having like a study on this. But that's what we need. Luke 11. And I said 51, but let's start in verse 50. Jesus is speaking here. He says, that the blood of all the prophets which was shed from the foundation of the world may be required of this generation. From the blood of Abel unto the blood of Zacharias, which perished between the altar and the temple, verily I say unto you, it shall be required of this generation. And there he's speaking about one of these last prophets that was killed there. You can read about it here in Chronicles. It's a shame. In fact, he was killed by if we go to chapter 24, we can do that. 2 Chronicles chapter 24, that is. One of the good kings of Israel when he was young was Joash. Remember Joash, the boy king? Mm-hmm. And he was famous for getting this big chest together, and people would put their donations in it to help rebuild the temple that was in ruins. But he didn't stay good all of his life. You know, we don't sometimes tell that part of the story. But after Jehoiada, the priest had died, he changed. It says, the Spirit of the Lord came upon, I'm in 2 Chronicles chapter 24, verse 20. It says, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon Zechariah, the son of Jehoiada, the priest, which stood above the people, and said unto them, thus saith God, why transgress ye the commandments of the Lord, that ye cannot prosper? Because ye have forsaken the Lord, he hath also forsaken you. And they conspired against him, and stoned him with stones, at the commandment of the king, in the court of the house of the Lord. Thus Joash the king remembered not the kindness which Jehoiada his father had done to him, but slew his son. And when he died, he said, the Lord look upon it and require it. And so when Jesus was speaking there in Luke chapter 11 about the blood of righteous Abel down to Zechariah, that's what he was referring to. The first martyr being Abel and this last one of the Old Testament that was recorded. And so being a prophet could be dangerous. It got John the Baptist killed, didn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It got John the Baptist beheaded. Stephen died. He was the first Christian martyr. And if he didn't have it before, he certainly had it during his last trial as he was before the people. He says heaven was opened. He saw God and Christ in Acts 7:52 in the heavens there. Christ at the right hand of God. And it got him killed. Well, John certainly was a prophet. It was prophesied that he would be a prophet by his father, even in Luke 1:76, Luke chapter 1 and verse 76. And thou, child, shall be called the prophet of the highest, for thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to prepare his way. And he certainly did, didn't he? And Jesus spoke of him as a great prophet in Matthew chapter 11 and verse 9. But what went ye out to see? A prophet? Yea, I say unto you, and more than a prophet. John was a great man in the eyes of God. I want to tell you that. Jesus himself claimed to be a prophet in Matthew chapter 13 and verse 57. And it says, and they were offended in him, but Jesus said unto them, a prophet is not without honor, save in his own country and in his own house. Jesus was claiming to be a prophet. He was claiming to be a prophet. And of course, he was a prophet. We know that in Acts chapter 2, if we could turn to Acts chapter 2, on the day of Pentecost, verses 17 and 18, Peter was saying that what they were seeing was prophesied by the prophet Joel. And that's, of course, in Joel chapter 2. And it shall come to pass in the last days, saith God, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And on my servants and on my handmaidens will I pour out in those days of my spirit, and they shall prophesy. So he's saying here that there would be this great gift given to the church. Prophetic ministry in the early church was actually very widespread and diverse. In Acts chapter 11, verses 27 and 28, we see here a band of prophets traveling from Jerusalem to Antioch. Acts chapter 11, verses 27 and 28. And in these days came prophets from Jerusalem unto Antioch. And there stood up one of them named Agabus, and signified by the Spirit that there should be great dearth throughout all the world, which came to pass in the days of Claudius Caesar. But it says that there was a band of them traveling. Prophets were active in many of the churches. In Acts 13:1, you read about the prophets in Antioch. In Acts chapter 21 and verse 4, prophets in Tyre. Caesarea was another place where Philip, the evangelist, had four daughters that prophesied. That's Acts chapter 21, verses 8 and 9, if you'd like to have the references. I'd like to read those, but because of the time factor, we're just going to give you the references, but you can check that out. Prophecy was one of the gifts of the Spirit designed for the edifying of the body of Christ. But it was also utilized in several of the churches. It was used in the Church of Rome, and I'll give you the reference, Romans 12, 6. In Corinth, 1 Corinthians 12, 7 through 11, and 14, 1 through 40. I mean, Paul speaks about it there to the Corinthian brethren a lot. We noted in Ephesians 4, 11, and Ephesians 2, 20, the gift of prophecy there. In Thessalonica, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 19 through 22, indicates that the gift of prophecy was active in that church. That was 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 19 through 22. And the gift of prophecy was to continue beyond the apostolic age, beyond the New Testament age. And we looked at a couple of these texts last week, but I'll just go to another one. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 11 says, He gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. Verse 12 tells us why with 13. For the perfecting of the saints. Now I'll ask you a question. Are we perfect yet?
No.
Are the saints ready yet? No, but we better be getting ready really soon, right?
Amen.
And that's what we're striving to get ready right now. But we're not perfect yet. And so He's given these things for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, until we all come into the unity of the faith. And to have that unity of the faith means to have the one mind. It means that we're all believing and teaching the same thing, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of us all, who is above all and in you all and through you all. Until we all come to the unity of faith and knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, and to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. In Revelation chapter 12, if we could turn there, and verse 17, Revelation 12, 17, and the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed. Now, what is the remnant? It's the very last part, isn't it? And went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God, and they have what else?
Testimony.
The testimony of Jesus Christ. That just isn't simply saying I'm giving a testimony about Jesus. It means something deeper, something far more significant. In Revelation chapter 19 and verse 10, it tells us exactly what that is. Mm-hmm. Revelation 19 verse 10. John says, I fell at his feet, at the feet of the angel, to worship him. And he, this angel, said unto me, See thou do it not. I am thy fellow servant, and of thy brethren that have the testimony of Jesus, worship God. Don't worship me. He says, worship God. He says, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. The spirit of prophecy. And so we can expect to see the gift of prophecy, especially among the remnant people. And then in Revelation chapter 16, here we read about the seven last plagues. And these plagues represent God's response after probation is closed to what man has done before probation closed. And if you'll notice in verse 4 through 6, the third angel poured out his vial upon the rivers and fountains of waters, and they became blood. And I heard the angel of the waters say, Thou art righteous, O Lord, which art and wast and shall be, because thou hast judged thus. For they have shed the blood of saints and prophets, and thou hast given them blood to drink, for they are worthy. It says they've shed the blood of saints. Well, we all want to be a saint, don't we? Right? But also the prophets. The prophets. So there are prophets living at the end time. Now, I'm not saying I'm one for sure. I'm not saying you are. I'm not saying someone's not right now. But I'm just saying it indicates that the gift of prophecy is extending in some form. In some form or another. In the twilight of Ellen White's life, there was a lot of questions whether there would be, I mean, you know, when I say in the twilight, when it was clear that she was aging and not getting well and things were not quite wrapping up yet, and she's probably going to die. And people were asking her, a lot of people had questions, you know, is there going to be another prophet? Are you going to have a successor? Is there going to be someone to take your place? And her grandson, Arthur White, wrote this in a biography about Ellen White, giving some of the history. He says, when Elder Campbell asked her if she had any light as to whether she would live till Jesus returned, she replied that she had no light on that matter. When he expressed his concern as to the welfare of the cause in her absence, she quietly replied, The Lord is perfectly able to take care of his cause. He then asked whether in the event she was called to rest, another would be raised up to take her place. Several of her books were lying on the table, on the writing table attached to her chair. Campbell reports that, quote, she spread her hands over them and said that in those books was outlined the information needed by our people for the rest of the journey. She chose to go no further in comment regarding a possible successor. Now, I would just like to say that's actually very true, even before Ellen White was alive. Someone could have taken the Bible and said, everything the people of God need is right here. Isn't it?
Yes.
I mean, if we turn to 2 Timothy chapter 3, can we do that?
Right.
2 Timothy chapter 3, Verse 16 says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be faulty. Man of God isn't quite ready yet. That the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished in all good works. So the Bible itself is self-sufficient. And our pioneers taught this and believed it, and they said, but because we didn't study the Bible as we ought, God gave us the testimonies. And that's what Ellen White said too. But Ellen White also wrote this. So the last quotation we looked at was actually a historical report, but not a quotation from Ellen White. What someone else was testifying, she said. And I don't doubt the veracity of it a bit. But here's something that she actually wrote herself. She says, there will be those who will claim to have visions. When God gives you clear evidence that the vision is from Him, you may accept it. But do not accept it on any other evidence, for people are going to be led more and more astray in foreign countries and in America. So she's not discounting that there could be other people who have visions or manifestations. But she says you have to test them. You have to test them. And we'll look at that in just a few minutes. Now, concerning this gift, it is a great gift, the gift of prophecy. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and verse 1, he says, follow after charity and desire spiritual gifts, but rather that ye may prophesy. And so the gift of prophecy was a wonderful thing. And he said, it's something we can desire. But friends, it's not necessarily something that we get to choose. Do you understand what I mean?
Yes.
I had a young student at Baysville High School several years ago. And I said, Lee, what are you going to do when you grow up? He said, I'm going to be a professional basketball player. I'm going to play in the NBA. Well, the guy couldn't even make the freshman team or the JV team, let alone the varsity team. There's no way this poor kid was ever going to play. I mean, he wanted to play in the NBA. That's what he wanted to do. And so his counselor told him, he says, well, you know, Lee, he says, there's just not a lot of openings there. You know, there's a select number of openings. Maybe you should look at something that will give you a little more chance. He said, okay. He said, I'll be a professional baseball player then. You know, I'm just positive. I just am positive that this young man is not playing in the NBA today, nor is he playing the Major League Baseball today. He didn't get to choose what he wanted. And we don't always get to choose what we want either, friends, and spiritual gifts. We can desire things. We can have an earnest, sincere desire. But our first and foremost desire should be to do God's will.
Amen.
And whatever His will is for us, whatever He chooses for us. I'll be very honest. I didn't choose to be a preacher. And if I chose to be a preacher, I shouldn't be here today. God chose me to be a preacher. But in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, here Paul says in verse 29 and 30 and 31, he says, are all apostles? And of course, his implied answer is no. Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Are all workers of miracles? Have all the gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? But covet earnestly the best gifts, and yet I show unto you a more perfect or more excellent way, and that is the way of love. But he says, you can covet or you can desire. The word covet is not the exact same kind of sense that when the commandment says, thou shalt not covet, it means to have a righteous desire for. But God dispenses His gifts as it pleases Him. He bestows one gift upon one, and another gift upon another, but all for the good of the whole body. Counsels to Parents, Teachers, and Students, page 314.3. So God is the one who gets to make the choice here. And He chooses this gift or that gift for a particular individual because He knows what is best. But again, the purpose of all this is for the edifying of His people, the building up of His church. And He knows what's best for that. We don't. In 1 Corinthians 14 again, in verse 3, it says, but he that prophesieth speaketh unto men to edification and exhortation and comfort. He that speaketh in an unknown tongue edifieth himself, but he that prophesieth edifieth the church. And so this concept of edifying the church was important. Prophecy brings conviction to sinners. In 1 Corinthians 14 and verses 24 and 25. But if all prophesy, and there come in one that believeth not, or one unlearned, he is convinced of all, he is judged of all. And thus are the secrets of his heart made manifest. And so falling down on his face, he will worship God and report that God is in you of a truth. And so seeing this gift of prophecy manifested would help bring conviction to this individual to give his life to God, to confess that he was nothing and God was everything. Paul envisions those who prophesy as teachers in 1 Corinthians 14:31. For ye may all prophesy by one, that ye may all learn, and all may be comforted. Luke describes situations in which prophecy serves to provide divine direction for ministry. And I think we related that in Acts chapter 13 and verse 1. It says, now there were in the church that was at Antioch certain prophets and teachers, as Barnabas and Simeon, that was called Niger, and Lucius of Cyrene, and Manaen, which had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch and Saul. And they ministered to the Lord and fasted. As they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them. And when they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, they sent them away. So the Holy Ghost sent a message through these prophets about Barnabas and Saul, giving divine direction. We noted, I believe, in Acts chapter 21, verse 4. It says, in finding disciples, we tarried there 7 days, who said to Paul through the Spirit that he should not go to Jerusalem. And verse 10, and as we tarried there many days, there came down from Judea a certain prophet named Agabus. Remember, we read about Agabus earlier. And when he was come unto us, he took Paul's girdle and bound his own hands and feet and said, thus saith the Holy Ghost, so shall the Jews at Jerusalem bind the man that owneth this girdle and shall deliver him into the hands of the Gentiles. And we could read on about that. Now, God again is saying that this is a wonderful gift and it's manifested in the New Testament in many ways that was a blessing to the church. But again, just like there are false teachers and false apostles, there are false prophets, and they must be tested and subject to the prophets. In 1 Corinthians 14 and verse 32, it says, and the spirits of the prophets are subject to the prophets. In other words, the prophets that have been established, that have written already, that have told us things, the new prophets coming along, they must be subject to those prophets. They must, their teachings, their writings, their sayings must be in agreement. And if they're not, they're not real prophets. They're not real prophets. And in fact, if you read verses 36 through 38 here, it says, what? Came the word of God out from you, or came it unto you only? If any man thinketh himself to be a prophet, or spiritual, let him acknowledge that the things that I write unto you are the commandments of the Lord. But if any man be ignorant, let him be ignorant. Paul is saying, if this person claims to be a prophet, they have to acknowledge what I'm saying first. They have to be subject to the prophet. Another translation just says, or was it from you that the word of God came? Or are you the only ones it has reached? If anyone thinks that he is a prophet or spiritual, he should acknowledge that the things I am writing to you are a command of the Lord. If anyone does not recognize this, he is not recognized. In other words, if you don't recognize the things that have, of the ones who have come before, you shouldn't be recognized yourself. And so the prophets are to be tested. Christians are not to gullibly embrace all those who claim to be possessed with the prophetic gift. We noted that. John says that we are to test the prophets. 1 John chapter 4 and verse 1. He says, beloved, believe not every spirit, but try. And when it says try the spirits, it means test the spirits, whether they are of God, because many false what? Prophets are gone out into the world. And that is a fact. In 2 John, verse 7. It says, many deceivers are entered into the world who confess not that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. This is a deceiver and an antichrist. Verse 8, look to yourselves that we lose not those things which we have wrought, but that we receive a full reward. Verse 9, whosoever transgresses and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ hath not God. He that abideth in the doctrine of Christ, he hath both the Father and the Son. Verse 10, if there come any unto you, and bring not this doctrine, that would be a deceiver. That would be one of those false prophets John's been writing about. He says, receive him not into your house, neither bid him Godspeed. Verse 11, for he that biddeth him Godspeed is partaker of his evil deeds. Notice the focus here is on two things. The focus is on the incarnation, and the focus is on the Father and the Son. Whether Christ has come in the flesh, and he has the doctrine of Christ, has the doctrine of the Father also. And John elaborates this also in other places. But these also perhaps help us to understand Revelation chapter 19:10, that the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. And in other words, all true prophecy is from Christ and bears witness to Jesus Christ. Prophetic revelation is not only rooted in the gospel of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, its ultimate aim or primary focus is also to bear witness to the person of the incarnate Son of God. Prophecy, therefore, must be fundamentally Christ-centered.
Amen.
In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, we have a very short command. I'll turn back there in case you don't remember. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 20. I'll read verse 19 with it. It says, quench not the spirit, despise not prophesyings. And certainly we should not do either of those things. But friends, we better make sure that we know what spirit we are dealing with. We better make sure we know if we're dealing with a true prophet or not, right? Because he says to quench not the spirit, but friends, if it's the spirit of the devil, we should very much quench it, right? He's speaking about the spirit of God. He says, despise not prophesying. If it's false prophets, false prophecies, we ought to be despising those, right? But it's when we know something is coming from God, when it has all the earmarks, all the tests, and we don't have time today to go into a study of the earmarks of the prophets, although there's going to be a section in the notes that are available after this sermon on that, the test of a prophet, how you can determine this. But it says to despise not this prophesying. Now, there have been, in the Seventh-day Adventist movement, when Ellen White was alive and then shortly thereafter, two special situations that the church was confronted with. And I'm just going to give you a little history quickly. But there was a woman by the name of Anna Rice Phillips, and she lived somewhat contemporaneously with Ellen White. She was born in 1865, and she died in 1926. But she came to the place that she claimed to be a prophetess. She thought she was having visions and dreams, and there were some leaders in the church that really thought she was the genuine tool. They thought that there was another manifestation, along with Ellen White, of the spirit of prophecy. People like W.W. Prescott, A.T. Jones especially, were quite taken up with her sayings. But Ellen White understood that she really did not have the prophetic gift at all, and that she was deceived. And yet Ellen White understood that she was a sincere person, and I think that's important to note. Just like we read in Jeremiah, that the heart is deceitful, it's desperately wicked, who can know it? Sometimes we don't know our own hearts, and Anna Phillips just didn't know her own heart. And Ellen White wrote about this situation. She wrote very kindly and redemptively. And Anna Phillips repudiated her experience, and she actually ended up becoming a trusted Bible worker in the church. That's right. But there was another lady who came a little bit later. Her name was Margaret Rowan, and she claimed to receive visions. And she later formed an alternate short-lived church called the Reformed Seventh-day Adventist Church, not to be confused with what we today call the Reformed Movement. But she became an Adventist in 1912, and she claimed to receive her first vision in 1916, which was shortly after Ellen White had died. And she shared it with some members of a church in Los Angeles, and they got a following together, and eventually it was about 1,000 people that were following this movement. But in 1920, a false document was planted by one of these so-called believers among the papers of Ellen White in the White Estate. And it was stating something to the effect of that Ellen White had said that she had a successor, and this woman was going to be her successor to the prophetic gift. Can you imagine that?
What was her last name?
Rowan, R-O-W-E-N. Anyhow, that eventually fizzled out. That eventually fizzled out. But I just want to share one more thought before we have to close today. And then for those who can stay by for the 2 o'clock session, we will go into any more details and look at some more things if you want. But she says this, I've been shown many who will claim to be especially taught of God and will attempt to lead others. And from mistaken ideas of duty, they will undertake a work that God has never laid upon them. Confusion will be the result. Let everyone seek God most earnestly for himself, that he may individually understand his will. So, you know, I just hope, and I think it would be great. That's the Selected Messages, Book 2, page 72.1. The reference is Selected Messages, Book 2, page 72.1. It's from Letter 54, written in 1893. So, Ellen White never said there would never be any more gift of prophecy in the church. The Bible indicates there will be gifts of prophecy. We may not ever experience those. We may never see it. It could be localized prophets. Maybe in Uganda. Maybe in China. I mean, there are many Adventists who have claimed that God has shown them various things throughout the years. But do we expect to see someone who's going to be like another Ellen White and write many books and have a universal work in the church? I don't think so. I'm not saying God can't do that, but I tell you what, he's given us so much already. And if we don't use what he's given us, why is he going to give us any more?
That's right.
You know. But sometimes God does do special things at special times because there isn't specific counsel for specific situations that comes up. I mean, even in the Bible, you know, we could meet a situation today that we don't have any knowledge of how we're going to deal with it. You know, there may be some principles, but we don't understand from the principles the best way to approach a subject. And God could put the inspiration upon Brother Allen here or someone to tell us this is the word of the Lord in this situation. But we need to test the prophets. We need to find out if they're really speaking according to the word of the Lord. And if they are, then by all means we should support that. Despise not prophesying. But if it's not, woe unto that person. Woe unto that person. May God have mercy upon Israel, friends. We need mercy today. But I encourage each one of you to study spiritual gifts, to study especially the gift of prophecy, to understand what God has for you today. But I am especially, especially thankful today for the gift of prophecy in the ministry of Ellen G. White.
Amen.
You know, maybe this afternoon we can talk about her statement. She made a statement one day. And she said, I've never claimed to be a prophet. And it really upset some people. They didn't know what to do. And it's true, she never claimed to be a prophet. But she never denied having the role of a prophet. You know, you don't have to claim something to be something. You know, but she understood the problems that could be involved. She understood the prejudice that would be involved as soon as she said, I am a prophet. But certainly she was, and much more. And her writings bear that out. And as we study those writings, God will bless his people and prepare us for these last days.